Hi friends, and welcome to Crumbs from Gerard. There was this man who had a dog, and every time the dog saw a truck, it would run after the truck and then get tired and come back. The next truck it saw to run again after, then get tired and come back. And this went in day after day, until one day the neighbor of this man asked him, "You know, sometimes I wonder, will your dog ever catch a truck?" To which he said, "Well, that's what you are wondering. What I'm wondering is, once my dog does catch a truck, what's he going to do with the truck?" My dear friends, we all of us as human beings are persons with a purpose. We have a purpose for life. And all of us try to find our purpose in different ways. Christianity gives us a purpose for our living. And this is it in the very first number of the Catechism. It says, "God calls man to seek him, to know him, and to love him with all his strength." So this is the purpose given to us in the Catechism. Our very nature is to love God. Now, why should we love God? I give you three reasons. The first reason is because we are created to love God. Our very purpose, the very reason of our existence, is to love God. And this is what's given in the Bible. "Even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him, he destined us in love to be his sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will." Ignatius of Loyola puts it in this way, right at the beginning of the spiritual exercises: "The goal of our life is to live with God forever. God gave us life because he loves us. Our own response to love allows God's life to flow into us without limit." So here Ignatius gives us, in the spiritual exercises which has formed many saints, the very purpose of our life. That is to love God, and by loving God, we live the fullness of life. So that is the first reason. The second reason is because God is worthy of our love. Remember what Jesus tells us in the Bible, the pearl of great price. The man who finds this pearl of great price sells everything he has and then goes and buys that pearl. And that pearl is God himself. For the sake of God, we are ready to give up everything. He's worthy of our love. And the third reason is because we are commanded to love. That's given right through the Bible, that we must love God. Let me explain to you one key verse from the scripture. The Jews call it the Shema: "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, and with all your strength." So, we are commanded to love God. How can we be commanded to love God? We have understood this whole thing of love in a wrong way. Love is not something that we feel, but love is something that we do. So let me try to explain this commandment to love God. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart. Heart, as we understand, is feelings. But in the biblical understand, heart is not just feelings, though it is helpful and useful. Heart also is with the mind, and heart is with the will. So I may feel love for God, which is good. But as you know, even we good Christians, often we don't feel that kind of love. But we know in our minds that this is the right thing to do. And therefore we are committed, we will ourselves to love God, because we know we are called to love God. And this calls for commitment. Now we understand commitment so well, especially those of you who are married. On a marriage day, you commit yourself to love each other. Now obviously you don't feel love for each other at every moment of your life, but you know you are committed. And therefore, when you feel love for each other or don't feel love for each other, you will carry on loving because you are simply committed to love God. But now the commitment is not out of fear, as sometimes could happen even in our love of God. But it's commitment out of love. And therefore, this brings us to not just commitment, but a personal commitment. And this is what we see right through the Old Testament. We are called to know God. And the language of the Old Testament, our relationship with God, is a personal kind of relationship. As a father, as a mother, as a wife, as a husband, as a child of God, a relationship. That's what we are called to build. So when we say we must love God with all our heart, it is with feelings which are there, sometimes may not be there, but more so with our minds, we decide to love God and we are committed to love God with a will. The second, with all our mind. When we say we love God with all our mind, what do we mean by it? First of all, it means God's will. Whatever I do, I seek God's will. What does the Lord want of me to do? Not what do I want to do. Lord, what do you want me to do? And to put it in a very simple way is, as you've heard it before, WWJD. What would Jesus do? So in a circumstance today, if you want to decide, what is the will of God? What would Jesus do in this circumstance? And then mind care. First of all, knocking off negativity from our minds. Sometimes our minds are full of negativity, which we see maybe on the media and hear on the media, but also our conversation. So keeping negativity away and filling up our minds with positive thoughts through the media maybe also, but through our conversation, filling ourselves with beautiful thoughts. And the best place for that is the Bible. Therefore, pray for reading of the Bible daily. This will help us to fill our minds with positive thoughts and also get direction for living our lives as the Lord wants us to live our lives. So with all our heart, with all our mind, and finally, with all our strength. What does it mean to love God with all our strength? Two things must be kept in mind. With all our strength means with everything that we have. So with our possessions, our money, our talents, our time, everything. So two ways in which we need to understand this. First of all, that we are stewards of all that we have. We are managers. All that we have is not ours. It is God's. We are only asked to manage it. So my money, it's not mine. I don't decide what to do with my money. It is God's. So He decides and I only manage it well. And so with my time, so with my talents. Not what do I do with my talents. Lord, what do you want me to do with it? So in practice, my money. How can the Lord use my money to the best? I am a manager. So one way is your charities. There's a traditional understanding in the church of tithing. That is giving 10%. 10% of your money, but also 10% of your time, 10% of your talents to God. But importantly, and that comes to the second point, the first fruit. So I said, you are a steward, a manager of God's things. Now, the first fruit. You don't give the last part, the leftover, but the first fruit. The first fruit is the first part and the best part. So you don't give the leftover money that's left at the end of the month. The first 10%, or as the Lord did, you decide with the Lord, maybe 1%, but as the Lord leads you, I first give it to the Lord what the Lord wants and ask of me. My time, the first part of my time. So to give you an example, my relaxation, I'm relaxing and enjoying myself, and then suddenly someone comes and asks me for some favor which would take some time. So no, I want to spend my time. No, it's not yours. It's the Lord's time. So if this is what the Lord wants me to do, then I will go and reach out and help this person. So I am a steward of all that I have, and I give God in practice the first fruit of everything. So loving God with all your heart, first of all, means not just feelings, but your thinking and your willing also. With all your mind, doing the will of God. What does God want me to do? WWJD. What would Jesus do? Mind care, knocking off all negativity, whether it's from the media or your conversation, filling it with positivity, maybe through the media, but importantly through your conversation. And the most important place is a prayerful reading of scripture to fill your minds with what God wants of you. And third, with all your strength. All that I have is not mine. It is God's. I am only a steward, a manager. So I manage what God has given me, and I often practice the first fruit, everything that God wants, the best and first. Now what happens? You will begin to notice an integration, a connectivity in your whole life. Everything begins to connect. Second, decision making becomes so easy when you put God in the very center of your life, because you don't have to think of a thousand things. The one thing you have to think of is, what does God want me to do? Because I love Him, I only desire His will in my life. And the third fruit from all this is, you experience peace. Jesus now becomes our peace.